Jeffrey Epstein can never face justice for his horrific abuse of young girls through the early 2000s. But Prince Andrew, the third child of the Queen, could help authorities avenge the victims of Epstein by giving US prosecutors who continue to investigate the convicted pedophile's sex trafficking ring a detailed recount of his encounters with the disgraced financier to track down his co-conspirators and bring them to justice. His inaction, when he could easily help authorities, is baffling, but he may have one good reason to keep his lips shut. He's accused of being one of Epstein's shady customers. For such a wretched story, linking everyone from President Donald Trump to the Clintons to Prince Andrew, the death of Epstein was not going to put the 66-year-old story to rest. In this special report, Sky News explores Prince Andrew's relationship with Epstein and combs through the public stalemate between the Duke of York and the US Department of Justice, which could expose a dark network that brushed shoulders with politicians, celebrities, and business tycoons. Prince Andrew is trying desperately to thwart an eruption over his ties to Jeffrey Epstein that threatens to transcend the Duke of York and erode trust in the whole British family. Virginia Giuffre, who used to be called Virginia Roberts, said she was trafficked by Epstein and forced to have sex with the prince, beginning when she was a teenager. But Andrew has categorically denied the allegations.
Let's talk about Jane Doe 102, Virginia Roberts. Do you know Virginia Roberts? So she's again who?
US investigators have wanted to speak with Andrew for months, not as a suspect, but as a witness about his friendship with Epstein as part of their inquiry into possible co-conspirators.
He's not directly involved so far. He would be an alleged witness in a civil case. The case is essentially against the Epstein estate, and those who were wrong should be awarded costs.
In July 2019, federal prosecutors charged Epstein in New York with sex trafficking of minors and conspiracy to commit sex trafficking of minors. Between 2002 and 2005, Epstein is alleged to have sexually exploited and abused dozens of underage girls.
What was referred to as a revolving door of young girls. He apparently had sometimes prostitutes and friends who were adult women procure these young girls to come into his home. And some have said that that was up to several girls per day.
He pleaded not guilty to all charges and faced up to 45 years in prison if a conviction was secured. In August, he hanged himself in prison while awaiting trial. Whether the allegations against the prince are true or not, there's no denying it. Prince Andrew is bursting with crucial information about Epstein and his movements, including his network of powerful friends and whether they were complicit in, had knowledge of, or participated in his alleged sex trafficking operation. And the Duke has failed to deliver that information for months. Shortly after Epstein's suicide behind bars, Jeffrey Berman, who was then the attorney for the Southern District of New York, said the inquiry into Epstein's alleged sex trafficking conspiracy hadn't finished, and prosecutors remained committed to standing up for the brave young women who Berman said Epstein had abused. Attorney General William Barr also promised to bring charges against anyone who helped Epstein.
But let me assure you that this case will continue on against anyone who was complicit with Epstein. Any co-conspirators should not rest easy. The victims deserve justice, and they will get it.
Prince Andrew stepped away from royal duties in November last year after a disastrous interview with the BBC about his relationship with Epstein and allegations from Giuffre. His attempt to defend himself from Giuffre's allegations triggered a tidal wave of negative media coverage and evolved into a worldwide scandal that forced the prince to say, "I have asked Her Majesty if I may step back from public duties for the foreseeable future, and she has given her permission. I continue to unequivocally regret my ill-judged association with Jeffrey Epstein." His suicide has left many unanswered questions, particularly for his victims. Of course, I am willing to help any appropriate law enforcement agency with their investigations, if required. But Prince Andrew claims he's not the one who can squeal on Epstein's network, despite spending days at the financier's houses during his predatory years. The US Justice Department and Prince Andrew have since been embroiled in a public brawl, with both sides branding the other a liar. In January, Berman alerted the world that Andrew had offered zero cooperation with authorities on the Epstein case.
You know, ordinarily, our office doesn't comment on whether an individual cooperates or doesn't cooperate with our investigation. However, in Prince Andrew's case, he publicly offered, indeed in a press release, offered to cooperate with law enforcement investigating the crimes committed by Jeffrey Epstein and his co-conspirators. So I think in that context, it's fair for people to know whether Prince Andrew has followed through with that public commitment. So let me say that the Southern District of New York and the FBI have contacted Prince Andrew's attorneys and requested to interview Prince Andrew. And to date, Prince Andrew has provided zero cooperation. The original charges against Jeffrey Epstein contained a conspiracy charge, and we alleged that there were conspirators involved. And Jeffrey Epstein couldn't have done what he did without the assistance of others. And I can assure you that our investigation is moving forward.
How many important people have to be caught up in this? How many people know about this? Because when you know about something and you participate in it, in most cases under American law, you have criminal liability for that. So he can't, this can only be the tip of the iceberg.
In March, Berman raised the alarm again, accusing the prince of completely shutting the door on helping with the inquiry. In June, the prince's lawyers escalated tensions by saying Andrew had agreed to help the New York prosecutors on at least three occasions since the start of the year. In the statement, lawyers accused Berman of misleading the public with inaccurate comments about the prince that should never have been made. They suggested Berman and other US prosecutors were breaching their own confidentiality rules by talking about Andrew's cooperation, and were perhaps seeking publicity rather than accepting the assistance pre-offered. Within hours, Berman called the statement a ruse. He said Prince Andrew, yet again, sought to falsely portray himself to the public as eager and willing to cooperate with an ongoing federal criminal investigation into sex trafficking and related offences. Even though the prince has not given an interview to federal authorities, has repeatedly declined our request to schedule an interview, and nearly 4 months ago informed us unequivocally through the very same counsel who issued today's release that he would not come in for such an interview. Either the prince or Berman are lying, but it's still unclear who's telling the truth.
The latest revelation that there has been zero cooperation is really bad for Andrew. I think it looks really bad. It sounds really bad. It sounds like he's got something to hide. That's what lots of people here in the UK are thinking, and I'm sure around the world as well. And the problem is that it comes off as if he thinks he's above the law. There's an arrogant tone to this kind of, it's very dismissive of a pretty serious investigation in terms of his relations with Epstein and various young women.
However, one source close to the prince told The Spectator, Berman had misled the world and that the Duke's legal team has dozens of email exchanges with prosecutors, proving that there has been full cooperation, and claimed the Duke is being used as a lightning conductor for the Department of Justice and a battering ram for law firms who want to secure settlements from Epstein's estate.
All of this is purely a backdrop to the American civil litigation system. And that's not for, that's not run now for justice. It's run to enrich the American lawyers.
The latest eruption of public insults came as Berman's office took its brawl with the prince to the next level by issuing a formal request to the British Home Office, seeking its help obtaining an interview with Andrew. The request is known officially as a Mutual Legal Assistance Application, or MLA, which amounts to a demand for Britain to hand over Prince Andrew to be interviewed. The MLA treaty between the US and the UK is a method of cooperation between the two to get assistance in an investigation or prosecution of criminal matters. While Prince Andrew hasn't been charged with any criminal offence in the US, UK agencies are obliged to help US prosecutors with their investigation. Lawyers say this MLA application means investigators could request Prince Andrew provide a witness statement or ask him to provide documents or property relating to the investigation. And while Prince Andrew can't be forced to cooperate, investigators have the full battery of powers available to British investigators and prosecutors at their disposal to gather evidence, including witness summons and search warrants. If Prince Andrew refuses to help US prosecutors, a nightmare scenario could unfold, opening the royal family up to an invasive investigation which could embarrass the throne. If Andrew was summoned to appear before court, he could stay silent to avoid self-incrimination, but failing to cooperate could trigger further legal proceedings. If the prince becomes the subject of US prosecutors' inquiry, rather than a possible helpful witness, extradition proceedings could be the next step. But the US Attorney General, William Barr, said in June there were no plans to extradite Prince Andrew to the US for questioning.
I don't think it's a question of handing him over. I think it's just a question of having him provide some evidence. But beyond that, I'm not going to comment.
So extradition?
No.
Just asking for evidence.
Berman's pursuit of Andrew hit a roadblock in June after the Trump administration fired him, which could give the prince a break from the barrage of demands that the US prosecutors are hurling at him. Now, a victim's lawyer called Spencer Coovan has reportedly called Berman's sacking highly suspect, suggesting the Trump administration might have fired the attorney after refusing its requests to stop investigating Prince Andrew. Berman was removed from office less than 2 weeks after Prince Andrew's lawyers publicly attacked him. Coovan told The Sun, all of a sudden, the one man that's been pushing for those requests has been fired for no reason. We also know that President Trump has a very close relationship with the British Prime Minister, and there have been requests that have been made in the past by our president to back off international prosecutions. Trump maintains he was not involved in Berman's firing.
That's his department, not my department. But we have a very capable Attorney General, so that's really up to him. I'm not involved.
Speculation swirling online suggests Berman was getting close to finding out about co-conspirators, which could include President Donald Trump, who has been swept up in Epstein's allegations. A lawsuit filed in New York by a woman claimed she was raped by Donald Trump at a party in Epstein's New York mansion in 1994 when she was 13 years old. Trump and Epstein both categorically denied it ever happened. In 2002, Trump infamously said, "I've known Jeff for 15 years. Terrific guy. He's a lot of fun to be with. It is even said he likes beautiful women as much as I do. And many of them are on the younger side." Perhaps Berman's replacement will have better luck securing an interview with the prince, who may be keeping quiet to avoid implicating himself. Prince Andrew said he first met Epstein in 1999 through Ghislaine Maxwell, Epstein's former British girlfriend and alleged co-conspirator, who the prince said he had known since he was at university. Allegations against Epstein started to surface in 2005, when the parents of a 14-year-old girl told Florida police he molested their daughter.
Hello. Hi, how are you?
I'm good. I'm returning your call. I apologize. I don't know exactly what for.
It's okay. It was an incident that occurred maybe like three and a half weeks ago with one of my stepdaughters. Wednesday at school, who got into a fight and she had over $300 on her. So after asking her what was going on, found out that ended up being that they went to Palm Beach to a gentleman's house and they start off by giving this gentleman a massage and he pays them if he likes them and he thinks that they're pretty enough, he keeps them around to do other things.
Okay.
So I wasn't quite sure if there was an investigation or if you guys had any word.
This is the first I'm hearing of it.
Okay.
What I will need is some more information. Would your stepdaughter be willing to come in to provide me with a statement?
Epstein was known for jetting around the globe from property to property on his plane appropriately named the Lolita Express. Lolita meaning sexually promiscuous young girl.
Called Lolita Express for a reason. That was a vessel for him to be able to abuse girls.
Despite being charged in May 2006, along with two of his assistants, with multiple counts of unlawful sex with a minor, the next month, Epstein attended a ball at Windsor Castle for the 18th birthday of Prince Andrew's daughter, Princess Beatrice. Andrew says Epstein didn't mention the investigation, had been invited through Maxwell as a plus one, and was unaware when the invitation was sent out exactly what legal proceedings were afoot in the United States. Epstein managed to secure a controversial, lenient secret plea deal, allowing him to escape a federal prison sentence and receive immunity from federal prosecution. As part of the arrangement, Alexander Acosta, then US attorney and former Secretary of Labor in the Trump administration, agreed the deal would be kept from victims and said he didn't go hard on Epstein because he believed he belonged to intelligence.
That suggests that he had some very powerful friends, possibly people in intelligence services, either the United States or other countries working with the United States, which, if true, is certainly a massive scandal. If he was exploiting children to gain dirt on prominent people, whether they be in this country or other countries, and working with U.S. intelligence, that would be a major scandal.
In June 2008, Epstein pleaded guilty to one count of solicitation of prostitution and one count of solicitation of prostitution with a minor and received an 18-month prison sentence.
Have you ever been convicted of a crime?
Yes.
What was the crime of which you were convicted?
Two counts, one soliciting prostitution and procuring a minor for prostitution.
Not only would Epstein serve just 13 months in jail from a cell he was allowed to leave 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, but the deal, called a non-prosecution agreement, essentially shut down an ongoing FBI investigation into whether there were more victims and other powerful people who took part in Epstein's crimes. The deal also included wording that granted immunity to any potential co-conspirators who were involved in Epstein's crimes.
What is unusual about the non-prosecution agreement is that it granted immunity to all potential co-conspirators. That is something I have certainly never seen. I don't know any lawyer that has ever seen a prosecution agreement that granted immunity to potential co-conspirators, basically shutting down the entire investigation.
After Epstein served his pitifully short sentence, the prince was photographed strolling in New York's Central Park with the convicted sex offender in December 2010.
The royal brand has been significantly damaged by this whole affair. Prince Andrew has brought the royal family into disrepute. And that's extraordinary that somebody who is a Prince of England would go and meet with somebody who has these convictions. Now, he was convicted of procuring sex with an underage girl, and there were other charges that were dropped. So you've got to question Prince Andrew's decision-making in this matter.
Andrew says he travelled to the States to break off his relationship with Epstein, a visit he now regrets. And that was when this photo was taken. Footage also caught Andrew inside Epstein's New York mansion, waving goodbye to women. Prince Andrew described Epstein's house as a bustling thoroughfare, where people came and went all the time. At the time Andrew was caught visiting Epstein, he dodged criticism until his ex-wife, Sarah Ferguson, admitted to accepting £15,000 from the convicted sex offender in 2011 to pay off debts. Shockwaves from the revelation hit Andrew fast, who quit his role as a UK travel envoy in July 2011. It wasn't until 2015 that allegations against the prince surfaced, dating back to 2001, when Andrew was named in court papers in Florida as part of a civil case against Epstein. Giuffre claimed she was forced to have sex with Prince Andrew on three occasions, including in 2001, when she was just 17 in London, then again in Epstein's New York mansion, and in the US Virgin Islands. The details were later struck from the record when a judge ruled they were unnecessary to the case. Prince Andrew said he had no recollection of this photo being taken, said to be snapped by Epstein himself in Maxwell's house, with his arm around teenage Giuffre. Another claim, from documents in a defamation case released by a judge in 2019, alleged Prince Andrew groped another woman's breasts on a couch in Epstein's New York apartment in 2001. Giuffre claimed she was defamed when Maxwell dismissed the validity of allegations that she was forced to sexually service wealthy and powerful men. Both the Prince and Buckingham Palace have denied all allegations against Andrew. But if Andrew and the Crown are telling the truth, it's time the Prince detailed every contact and movement Epstein and his associates had in his presence during those predatory years, so justice can be served. Anything short of Andrew offering a meticulous interview with authorities screams of guilt and perhaps fear of reprisals from Epstein's dark network. Andrew's silence is especially significant given Epstein and his associates have vanished under curious circumstances.
The federal investigation so far has shown that the guards who were supposed to be guarding Jeffrey Epstein the night that he apparently killed himself falsified logs to make it appear that they had checked on him when in fact they had not. It's not clear yet exactly how much time he had, but certainly if the 30-minute checks that were regularly intended were not made, he would have had some window to harm himself.
I do not understand how anyone can explain not having him under 24-hour surveillance. He got three strong reasons why this man may be done in. He might commit suicide, he apparently attempted it, or he was attacked. That threat still remained even after a week. And the third one is maybe a prisoner on his own is just going to take him out.
Supermarket magnate Ron Burkle died in January with no cause of death given. Film financier Steve Bing leapt from the 27th floor of a building in June. And Maxwell has disappeared from the face of the earth, surfacing only in reports from time to time in different locations.
He kept a lot of very powerful people very close, and it's for that reason that a lot of conspiracy theories have really been sparked since his death, because there was a lot of discussion about whether or not, and not necessarily anybody that I've just named, but whether or not any of these close and powerful friends of his were concerned that their names were going to come out in his impending trial.
The Prince can't stay quiet anymore. Something insidious is afoot. In his words, he is duty bound to put Epstein's dark network to rest. Philip Ritchie, Sky News.